bit of delay, before Raymond comes up to the stage and talks about you know, his solution to some of the educational problems out there, he's going to actually run a video about STEAM coders. So enjoy the show.
STEAM Coders teaches underrepresented and underserved students of color the fundamentals of science, technology, engineering, art, and math, or STEAM, in preparation for academic and career opportunities. STEAM Coders offers students a fun and easy introduction to the STEAM subjects. We educate, inspire, and equip students with the knowledge and resources needed to successfully pursue STEAM opportunities.
Sorry about that, guys. Just a second.
STEAM Coders teaches underrepresented and underserved students of color the fundamentals of science, technology, engineering, art, and math, or STEAM, in preparation for academic and career opportunities. STEAM Coders offers students a fun and easy introduction to the STEAM subjects. We educate, inspire, and equip students with the knowledge and resources needed to successfully pursue STEAM opportunities. Our goal is to aim higher. We focus on accessibility, instruction, and mentoring. STEAM Coders emerged from the Gamma Zeta Boulay Foundation's award-winning LAMP Mentor Program in the summer of 2014. The goal was to provide underrepresented and underserved students of color with hands-on computer science instruction. A lack of exposure to the STEAM disciplines during their early childhood education period put students at a distinct disadvantage for future success in these fields. As a result, they're not adequately prepared to pursue STEAM opportunities after graduating from college. STEAM Coders uses idle computer labs and classrooms to bring computer science and robotics courses to disadvantaged students. Classes are held after school and Saturday mornings. Students engage in a variety of computer science applications, mobile app development, video game development, cybersecurity, and robotics, among others. At the end of each session, students receive a STEAM Coder certificate of completion, but more importantly, they acquire aptitude, confidence, and in most cases, the curiosity and motivation for continued learning. As STEAM Coders, we strongly believe that no one segment of society has a monopoly on great ideas. Talent is everywhere, along with imagination and innovation. We have to remove the blinders, take down the barriers, and unlock the doors to our institutions and invite the underrepresented and underserved students inside. For more information about STEAM Coders, please visit www.steamcoders.org. Full steam ahead.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Raymond Ealy. I wanted to look professional. I have my sports jacket, but man, it's hot in here.
So the energy.
I'm going to be casual. I'm the executive director and founder of STEAM Coders. We started in 2014 in the summer in Pasadena. We started as a spinoff of an organization called the Gamma Zeta Boulay Foundation. And that was an organization for young African-American males, grades 9 through 12, and it was a soft skill training program to prepare them for college. So the only requirement was that you had to want to go and graduate from college. So we had young men, grades 9 through 12, they were public school, they were private school, and the goal was to sharpen up their soft skills. So we had interviews, we had mock interviews. We bring in professionals from the local community, doctors, lawyers, police chiefs, just about anybody, entrepreneurs, anybody you can name, and talk to the students. We would take them on local field trips to a lot of the Pasadena landmarks. Philosophy was, before you want to go out and conquer the world, it'd be nice to know what's in your backyard in Pasadena. So we took them to the Art Center. We took them to Huntington Guard Library. We took them to Caltech, JPL, everywhere. And we would talk to them. We took them to Nordstrom. We took them to a dress for success session. We taught them the difference between dressing for Friday and Saturday night and dressing for an interview. Okay? No black shirts with black ties. So we did a lot of things that they didn't know. Some of these kids came from single parent households. Some didn't. And we found that they all were the same. They didn't know anything. So our goal was to get them up to a level where they felt confident. We took them to a restaurant, and we would have a formal meal. We told them bread, water, meal, everything, so they understood how to comport themselves when they were in a different setting. So we wanted to really polish them up and get them ready to move out there. So as a result of that, we had a lot of parents who had daughters, and they came to us and said, we love this program, can you do anything for our daughters? Since we were a male, all-male organization, a fraternity, we knew some other female-oriented organizations in town, so we said, we have a better solution for you. We are men, we know about boys, we don't know anything about girls. So we referred them to a lot of different organizations. Everybody was happy, and they came back and they said, what about our younger kids? We have younger boys. And we said, okay. And we looked around town, and we could not find any organizations. So we started talking to some educators and some community people and said, what do we do for middle school kids? We need a companion piece. And the answer was, well, you know, STEM is hot. You probably should want to do something in that field, and that's what I would recommend. So we talked to some more people, and everybody was STEM. So we said, okay, sounds good. So we put together some resources, some people who could teach, and some other things, and we came to the conclusion that it was a go. So in the summer of July 2014, we decided to try a coding class, but we didn't have a facility. We didn't have a classroom, we didn't have a lab. So a good friend, Dana Walker-Jewick at the Art Center, who runs the Raymond Avenue campus, Saturday School they called it, and I went to Dana and said, Dana, we've come up with this great idea, and we need a classroom, we need a computer lab. She said, what is it called? We said, STEM Coders. I was really excited. And she said, So she said, okay, so tell me what you want to do. So I walked her through it. She said, you know, that sounds good. She said, I have a lab that's not used on Saturday mornings in classroom space. She said, but there's only one caveat. I said, what? She said, where's the art and design? I said, I don't know, where is it? She said, well, you gotta have art and design as all part. So she kind of laid it down to me, and she said, if you agree to change the name to STEAM Coders, then I'll let you use the space. So I said, you have a deal. So when I went back to the group with the great news, we have a lab, we have a classroom, and STEAM Coders is ready for business. They're going, where did that come from? It's a long story, but just trust me. So basically what we do is, everybody thinks we want to teach kids how to be computer coders, which is not bad. But that's not really what we want to do. We want to teach them how to think. Logic and critical thinking is what we want to do with a lot of these kids. So that way they can take the skills that they learn and go into a lot of different areas. They're not pigeonholed into one particular area. So that's what we do. And you know, the thoughts on education are far and wide on what the intent of education, but what you find is like minds think alike. So you have this quote from Martin Luther King about how he feels education should be and what the benefits of education. But you also have a similar logic from Steve Jobs about what he thinks education should be. So we're all pretty much, whether we're in the public sector or the private sector, we agree on the value of education and what it could do for our community, for what it can do for our country, and what it could do for the world. Now the key is, how do we make this happen? And the difficulty about this is that there are large segments of our society that are pretty much cut off from all the good things. And we have to find a way to connect the dots. You know, people always talk about the digital divide, where it exists, does it still exist, is it getting narrow, is it getting wider? Well, I can tell you my experience being on the ground, going to different schools, going to different communities, I haven't seen a significant change in a digital divide. I go to schools in the city of Pasadena where there's no computer lab, there's no laptop, there are no Chromebooks, there's no computer science curriculum, and there's no computer science instructor. Now we're talking about a global city. We have worldwide institutions, iconic institutions, Caltech, JPL, you name it, Art Center. And we have schools that don't have technology. It's baffling. So when people say that the digital divide is narrowing, they have to get on the ground and walk around and go visit some of these places, they'll see. And we're surrounded by areas where kids have multiple devices. La Cañada, San Marino, Arcadia, some of the top school districts in the state of California. You have kids that have laptops, they have desktops, they have smartphones, they have tablets, they have everything. And I can walk into a school right now in Pasadena where a kid has absolutely nothing. And at some point in time, they're gonna meet to compete for a spot at UCLA, and everybody knows UCLA gets 112,000 applications for their freshman class. So if you've had K through 8, you've had no technology, no computer science, and you've been in a school district that's had it since kindergarten, when we become 12th graders, it's really unreasonable to expect that there's going to be any kind of competition. And why people believe that, I don't know, but it's unrealistic. So we have a large segment of society that's pretty much shut out. So what we want to do is try to fix that, but we can't wait until they graduate college. We can't wait until they graduate high school. We got to get them deeper. As you can see by some of these numbers, we have African-American, Hispanic students don't even take AP courses. So if you don't take an AP course, I'm not really sure how you get into the UC system. But what makes it even worse, there are high schools that don't even offer AP courses. They say you could take it at the high school in the next district or someplace else. So you can't even do it in your home school. So you're already at a disadvantage. So, you know, now you're going to battle and you don't have any weapons. So it's unrealistic to think that kid has really a fighting chance. Even if he's a genius, he's so far behind, he's going to spend all his energy just trying to catch up, or by that time the train has left the station. Now the worst part about this is that it doesn't get any better once they graduate. You know, everybody knows the stats in some of these places are horrific, to say the least. And it's not a matter of just straight equity and just straight fairness. Sometimes people get a little bent out of shape when they talk about diversity and affirmative action because everybody believes it leads to quotas. And it really doesn't lead to quotas. If you're in a room and you're talking strategy and you're talking marketing and you're talking about how to move your business forward, you need a diversity of ideas in the room. If it's an all-male room, then you come out with ideas all male. They call that the man cave. There's nothing wrong with it. I've been in them. I'm happy. However, my wife may not share that same sentiment. And if it's a room and it's all women, they have a different perspective. If it's a room and it's all African-American, there's a different perspective. If it's a room and it's all Hispanic or all Asian or all Armenian or all Hare Krishna, it's just going to be different. So you need a little bit of everybody in the room just so you can see. How many stories have we read about marketing where someone comes up with a fabulous name and then you go take that product to a different country and it's a bad word? Okay, so all of a sudden, somebody didn't know anybody. Well, because, you know, we were all from, you know, some community that didn't have any diversity. So we have to make sure from a business standpoint, we understand that we have diverse opinions and ideas because that adds to the mix, and it makes the product, it makes the company, it makes everything we do much stronger because we're taking in a lot of various opinions. So we have to make sure we do that. And if we're just pulling from the same pool of people, pulling from the same colleges, pulling from the same communities, it's not gonna work. And we're gonna pay the price for that eventually. The other problem is that the investment in California students is awful, okay? So as you can see, we spend very little, less than $10,000 to educate a student, and then we spend $60,000 plus to incarcerate a student. Uh-huh. Once you factor in recidivism, when they come out and then go back in, you get almost double that. So it's just a vicious circle, and it doesn't help anybody, because at the end of the day, we have to fund that. I'd rather fund education than another prison. Okay. I mean, it just doesn't make any sense. As boomers, okay, you have a choice here. One day you're going to retire, and one day you want to get some of the money that you put into the system that they've taken out every single paycheck. When you get your check, you always see those boxes where they're just taking money. So that's going to the people before us, right? They paid their dues, so we're supporting them. They're pulling some money out of the system. Now, in order for us to have that same benefit, at some point in time, when we retire, everybody behind us has to be gainfully employed, all right, and not at minimum wage, okay? And if that's not happening, that means our money's gonna be taking care of the old people and the young people, a la 60,000+. Okay, that's not sustainable. Everybody knows that. If you do the math, that's not sustainable. So we have to find ways to make everybody behind us productive in meaningful jobs, contributing to the system so that we're not 99 years old by the time we can draw on Social Security. Okay, our goal is to reach as many kids as we can. Right now, we're breaking through the 1,000 student mark, and there are tens of thousands of students out there that get zero computer science. So we have a lot of work to do, but we got to do it strategically, and we got to manage it so that we're not overextending ourselves. Okay, ethnically, we got a good mix of students. It kind of swings one way or the other. We have schools that are all Hispanic. We have some schools that are all female. We have some that are mixed, but what we find is they're all in the same boat. They have no access to technology, no access to computer science. They may not have any equipment at home. Their schools may not have any equipment. So we're trying to reach these kids to bring them into the zone to make them viable. What we'll find is that a lot of entrepreneurs, a lot of educators, a lot of different people here, and Silicon Valley, just to take a snapshot, I don't want to make them the main villain, but in the areas in which we want to go, you just find that everybody has the same exact issue. And that issue is there's a lack of talent. Silicon Valley spends millions of dollars trying to increase H-1B visas to bring back students from overseas to work here. There's no problem with that, but we have tens of thousands of people here who we should be educating. We should be preparing them for these jobs to contribute to our system. There's no reason we can't do that. The people who we want to bring back most of the time were student visas who went to school here in the United States. They went to UCLA, they went to Caltech, they went to USC. Why can't we have local kids do that? Why can't we have kids from Pasadena Unified wanting to go and being prepared to go to Caltech, wanting to go and being prepared to go to Art Center? That's what we have to do. We should have to import students to come take advantage of these facilities here. We shouldn't have to do that, because eventually they're going to do something because they're here. We have a situation where people will leave Mexico because they have no hope. They have no dreams. They look around them. There's nothing. They'll put a backpack on. They'll pay a stranger their life savings, and they'll try to cross this border because they know in their hearts that what they see around them growing up, there is absolutely nothing to look forward to. There's no dream, there's no nothing. And they'll risk life and limb to come over to the United States. They have no idea where they're gonna live, no idea where they're gonna eat, where they're gonna work. All they know is it's much better than where they came from. Here, if you grow up in certain areas, just take Imperial Gardens, Nickerson Gardens, anywhere, Jordan Downs, anywhere in South Central, projects as people refer to them. And if you grow up and you have zero hope and you have nothing, you see nothing, you have no imagination, you don't believe you can do anything, you're not gonna put a backpack on and go to Mexico. You're right here. We gotta deal with you. We're gonna see you every single day. You might be on a tent, you might be outside Starbucks begging, but we are gonna see you every single day. And at some point in time, we're gonna underwrite something that you do. If you're sick, you're gonna go to the hospital, we're gonna pay for it. If you commit a crime, you're gonna go to jail, and you see we pay $60,000 for you to do that. So we have to figure out ways to make people part of the system. They can't be on the outside looking in. They gotta be on the inside with us. These are some of our students. We have great partners out here. I'd like to acknowledge one group from Apple. Apple, can you raise your hand?
Apple people.
Apple. So Apple, we take students on Thursday evenings to the Apple store, and they teach them iMovie and GarageBand, a lot of fun stuff. The irony is these kids are local Pasadena Unified School District kids who go down to Old Town into the Apple store, and believe it or not, they've never ever been to the Apple store, ever in their lives. Sixth, seventh, eighth graders living in Pasadena have never stepped foot in the store, never touched an iPad, ever. We said, how many kids been in the store? Raise your hand. Nobody raises their hand. So maybe they didn't understand the question. Not that you didn't buy anything, but how many have just been in the store before, stuck your head in the door, raise your hand. Nobody raises their hand. This is after class after class after class after class, right in the middle of Pasadena. So we have issues. So we gotta make sure that we bring these kids into all of our institutions so they have some dreams and have some hope, okay? We have Pasadena City College. You'll see this class. Anybody here, raise their hand, Pasadena City College? A great, great partner. Saturday mornings, we use the CTEC lab. We bring kids in. We do a lot of events. We do robotics. We do computer science. So a lot of the institutions, we have Harvey Mudd. A lot of institutions have facilities and resources. On a Saturday morning, they're empty. So our goal is to, let's take advantage of that. Let's bring kids in. A lot of these kids go to schools that don't have these resources. We bring them in, we teach them. They get to walk around college campuses, look at college life. So we kind of empower them with the skill set, but more importantly, they get a complete understanding of what college life is like, what it looks like, and get there. You got to start them really low and get that dream moving forward so they can do that. We have a lot of different classes. We're always adding to the curriculum. We like to make sure that we let them touch a little bit of everything. We go wide as opposed to deep. And the reason we go wide is because a lot of these kids have never done anything. So we have to try to expose them to a lot of different things so they understand what's going on. One of our partners here, Ed Lee in the building? Ed Lee, Barnabas Robotics. Ed Lee has been partnering with us, taking his Arduino robotics classes to different schools. So the kids get to touch, build, program. They love everything they do because it's all new. And this is the generation that does not know life without an iPhone. So they really embrace technology. Here's one of our classes.
Gone through a different subsystem of each robot, and we ended this competition. So we have a course for them to go through, and they have different checkpoints that they have to make sure they can get to.
Have simple classes, student-teacher ratio is about 10 to 1. Sometimes it's less when we have volunteers. Any of you willing to volunteer, just let me know. And we try to make sure that the kids have a lot of attention. When we go to a college campus like a Harvey Mudd, they have student volunteers. Sometimes it's almost 1 to 1 with students. So the kids love that and the students love that. So we try to make sure that they get as much attention as possible. We do after school and Saturdays. We try to weave in field trips. We took a cohort of young girls from an Inglewood middle school to Google. And we thought that was gonna be a huge highlight. They were grades 6, 7, and 8. The principal told me that some of those girls, if you're familiar with Inglewood, every single road leading west goes straight to the Pacific Ocean. And what happens is they told us that some of those girls, 35% were in foster care, had never, ever, ever, ever been to the beach. I don't think it's 10 minutes away to school. Never ever been to the beach. They go more than 1 or 2 blocks away from their area, that's news. So we took them to Google, and after the tour, we had the bus park around the corner of Venice Beach, and we told those young ladies we had to walk to the beach, the bus, because they couldn't park, and no big deal. They said, how far is that? I said, it's probably a block and a half. A block and a half. I go, is that big a deal? They go, oh man, that is really? He can't come around? No. You're 6, 7, 8 great girl. You can't walk on a block and a half. Well, we weren't ready to do all of that. Okay. We go up half a block, turn the block, the beach. They ran to the beach. Just ran. We said, hey, ladies, we just wanted you to see it. We've never seen the beach. Can we just walk down? So we said, okay, just walk about halfway. It's the middle of the day. Just walk about halfway. Okay. Can we take our shoes off? We're not getting in the water. What are we doing? Well, we just want to feel the sand. We've never felt the sand. They're like, oh, we're looking at each other like, okay, we feel the sand. Okay. All right, let's go. How'd the sand feel? Good, let's go. Can we get shells? No shell. Why? We don't want anybody to know we went to the beach, and that's evidence. No shells. So we get them back on the bus, and we just say, okay, how'd you like Google? Fine, what did you do? What'd you say? Yeah, okay, everybody's good. So we sat back down, and I said, you think they're gonna tell? Someone said, I don't know, let me see. 6, 7, 8 year eighth grade girls, yes, they tell everything. So we got back up and said, okay, ladies, field trip was for Google, you know. So everybody understand that? Yeah, yeah, we got it. Google, 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 Google. Yes. We get to the school, first two girls off the bus, we went to the beach. My reputation is sullied with that school. So they get a certificate of completion. We make sure that they finish the class and they learn something before we give them a certificate. We don't walk around waving a certificate and they don't know how to code or they don't have to do robotics. So we try to make sure of that. And the goal is to have a well-rounded student population. That's what our goal is. Everybody should want that. Those are your future employees. Those are future coworkers. These are future citizens. These are future voters. Needless to say, have you seen the candidates for the election? These are our future politicians. We gotta train them. We don't wanna have this train wreck scenario anymore in our lives, okay? So we gotta make sure. So we went from 250 to 1,000 students. And we're growing every single month, okay? A lot of people out there. We go as far east as Laverne and Claremont and Pomona. We go in the South Bay. This Saturday, we're going to start up an all-girls cohort in the Long Beach Unified School District. We started in Inglewood. We're in Pasadena. So wherever there are kids, wherever there are underrepresented kids, underserved kids, disadvantaged, disenfranchised, whatever you want to call them, that's where we want to be. Okay, resources, we always need money. Is that any entrepreneurs in the house? We always need money, we always need volunteers, we need educators with curriculum, we need partners to help us figure out certain things. We don't have all the answers, we don't want to have all the answers. We want to have you, because you're experts in different areas, and we want to collaborate. We want to be part of the team, we don't want to be solo, okay? Parents love the opportunity to get their kids in the areas where they didn't know anything about. We have a lot of parents who are at the lower end of the economic scale. They didn't have these opportunities. They don't know anything about this. And we want to make sure that their kids have a better opportunity. I grew up, my mother was a housekeeper. She called it day's work. She cleaned houses. That's what she did. She had a fifth grade education, okay? But she always thought I didn't have to do that. So her goal always in life was, I'm going to do this so you don't have to do this. My mother knew nothing about college, but she worked for doctors and lawyers and investment bankers. I grew up in Long Island. And so she would just watch what they did and she would copy. When I was in 12th grade, my mother bought me a trunk, right? I came home one day and there was a trunk. And I said, so what's the story with the trunk? She said, for college. And I'm looking at her, she said, everybody I work for, the kids go to college, they buy them a trunk. That's your trunk. Okay, I got it. I said, so are you going to help me with the application too? No, that's up to you. But this is what you need. So we have to make sure that we're making sure everybody has an opportunity. And because the parent didn't have the opportunity, doesn't mean the kid didn't have the opportunity. Okay? We have some great partners, great partners. You see some of them listed here, some of them are not. Apple is not listed here. We have just a lot of people. And I would like to, Andy Wilson was already acknowledged. Andy Wilson is the Kaiser Sose of Pasadena. To some people, they've heard of him, he exists, but they don't know who he is, what he looked like. That's him right there. He's introduced me to so many different people. We've met people in a lot of different areas, a lot of different arenas that want to collaborate. Yesterday, we had a conversation with Art Center. We want to try to do a class with them. We're going to collaborate on a hackathon with JPL. Really, the whole goal is to just open up this world. We live in an area that's so unique where we have so many world-class institutions. There's probably more engineers per capita in Pasadena than any other city this size. And so we want to make sure that the kids have these opportunities. We want to get them into these places. They don't even know. They live in Pasadena. They've never heard of Idea Lab. They've never, ever been to the Art Center. They've never been to Caltech. They've never been to Huntington Library. We have kids on the other side of the planet, you know where these places are. We have kids who live 5 minutes away, have no idea where they are. That's not good, okay? Everybody needs to know where they are, okay? People watch the Rose Bowl, thing goes right by Norton Simon every single year. We have kids here who think that's a man who lives someplace in Pasadena. They have no idea what it is. We can fix that. thank one of our partners, Innovate Pasadena, that put us in touch with a lot of different people, including cross campus. And that's it.
Amazing presentation. Thank you so much for sharing that. It's just really inspiring to see someone with your background. I thought Raymond might talk about it a little bit, but it's worth mentioning. He has the perfect marriage of for-profit working for sort of
banks,
big companies, and also he's got the heart center that's focused on the, you know, the non-for-profit sector, and he's just trying to meld those two skill sets to create something that not just serving communities, but sustainably so. And you can see that in his growth. It's pretty impressive. I'm really inspired by that. So I think that's really great what he's doing. And right now we're gonna just open up to Q&A. So if you guys, for those of you who don't know, we save comments for offline. Raymond, will you be sticking around for?
Yes, I'd like to introduce one person before he leaves. Mr. Quentin Strode is trying to sneak out. He's the president of our board, Quentin. He likes to come and make sure I don't say anything inappropriate or that I don't kind of oversell his program. Once he's convinced that everything's okay, then he just leaves the building. Thank you.
Thank you. If you have a question, raise your hand. We'll walk around with the mic. Save your comments for offline. Thank you.
Just really quickly, can you go back one slide so that if people want to volunteer, they know how to get a hold of you?
That was the easiest question I ever had.
Who else has a question?
Questions, comments, volunteers, grants, donations? Yes, sir.
How many weeks are the classes and how long are the classes?
Our classes range. We have robotics classes that usually run about 6 weeks. So usually 2 times a week or 3 hours a week to 6. So that's about an 18-hour class. The coding classes will range anywhere, typically 8 weeks. Some school districts want us to do 9, some want us to do 10, so we try to match it around that. We'll do either 2 times a week, about 90 minutes, or we'll do Saturdays for 3 hours.
Over here. Question over here. Thank you very much. Wonderful program, very excited about listening to it. I teach at UCLA, so I'm getting great resonance for what you're saying with the work. But it seems like it is a phenomenal add-on to a system that's not doing this natively. How would we change what, let's say, in Pasadena Unified, for example, or the other great school districts you're working with, how do we change the start of this to get this earlier in the actual core?
Well, it's a good question. You know, in a perfect world, ideally, steam coders would sunset at some point. And the reason that is because the school districts would incorporate elements of this into their regular program and they would not need us. We thought we were going to be supplemental, but in some places we actually fill a void. But the school districts need to put coding and computer science on the same level that they're going to put math and English. Now, eventually they're going to have to do that in order for those kids to compete. Right now, they choose to do other things. Art doesn't exist in a lot of schools. Okay, so there are a lot of things that have been stripped out for various reasons. They have their own financial situations. You know, when the California proposition to put the cap on property tax just about annihilated certain school districts. Okay, and we're still paying the price for that. All right, so until they make it a priority, we're going to exist. Hopefully one day they'll make it a priority and integrate it into their main curriculum. And they would not need us. That would be a good story.
Hey, Ray.
How you doing?
I just thought, I know it's not supposed to comment, but I will. I get asked to be involved with startups all the time. And unfortunately, because of my time, I say most of the time. And the startups I like to get involved in are ones that are solving incredible problems that have incredible entrepreneurs. So I just want to say, Ray, it's a pleasure to help you, and we're super excited about what you're doing. And any way that I can continue to help the success you've had, it would be a tremendous opportunity to help your success. So thank you, Ray. Keep up the great work.
Thank you. And with Andy, typically when you get such positive comments, you always say the check is in the mail. But with Andy, he likes PayPal or wire transfer. So I'll make sure before we get out of here, you'll get that handy. All right, he's a professional. Yes.
Comment, I'm Pete Parker with the American Dream University. I'm working with startups. One of the startups I'm working with specifically aims to reduce the recidivism rate of people coming out of prison. So in doing some research for them, I found the following statistics. There are 650,000 people considered to be incarcerated in the state of California. However, about 400,000 of those are out of jail on parole. At $60,000 a year, that's 200,000 prisoners. That's a heck of a financial burden on California, and somebody ought to be able to figure out how to monetize that. So with the entrepreneurs in this room, look at this. This is more than a nonprofit. This is a nonprofit that can make money, be sustainable, and reduce the tax burden and the prison burden. You've got win, 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 win all over.
Thank you.
Hey, Ray, great job. By the way, I want to compliment you on the best video music soundtrack. including Return of the Mac in the first So I think I'd love to hear your comment, because this is something we run into in our work that's a subset of the question that was just asked about helping schools. You know, we worked with schools here locally in Pasadena where they actually have all the equipment. And I think sometimes we think equipment solves the problem, but they literally have never turned it on. And so that's like, for people in this room, I think a lot of us think that if we just get them the iPad or the computer or whatever it is, it solves things. And I know some people in this room know that's not true, but can you just talk about how that subset of a problem has been evident as you've been doing your work?
Well, it's interesting. Grant is with CodeSpark, who we're gonna do some stuff with this coming summer, so he's been a good partner as well. You know, it's interesting because we had a conversation with Art Center yesterday on some art and design courses that they're thinking about putting together for us to have our students. But one of the things that they said out of the gate is, we're going back to old school pencil and paper. So we're gonna try to put together some classes where they don't have to touch any equipment. So we don't want that to be an issue as we go from school to school, where the lack of equipment or the quality of the equipment is going to have an impact on the course. So they said we have to bring back more courses where they're writing, they're doing their storyboard, they're doing their wireframe, they're doing a lot of different things, and it's more coming from here than it is from touching a keyboard. So we have to figure out ways to circumvent the belief that everything is based on technology and not enough is done thinking, and to get the kids to realize that the lack of equipment, the lack of an iPad, the lack of a computer does not stop them from moving forward. So we have to be able to attack this from a lot of different angles, because some people do not have and will not have, but that cannot be an impediment to learning. So we have to figure out different ways. It's not a one size fits all. And we have to be able to make sure that the schools and the people teaching in the schools understand that the creative genes, the creative juice that you have can be used in a lot of different ways. The technology can help you move it forward perhaps a little quicker, but these ideas have to, you know, be in the mind and in the heart in order for you to get them out in something that's tangible. So that is a challenge, and that's something that we try to address or at least think about, because everybody thinks that just give them a Chromebook and all of a sudden everything's going to be solved, and that is really not the case.
One last question, Raymond.
Yes.
Hi, Raymond. It's Alexis doing? From Pasadena Playhouse.
How you doing? And we partnered with the Playhouse. We brought hundreds of kids there who've never, ever, ever, ever seen anything other than a school play where they were a tree. And we took them there and they've seen musicals and comedies, and they're just in awe of that. So that's another, I'm going to give you a round of applause, because that's been a life-changing event for kids locally that have absolutely never had no concept of the theater.
It's our pleasure. My question, I have two actually. The first is, in the realm of volunteerism,
yes.
Can you be specific with what you're looking for? And the second question is, in terms of your community partnerships, I'm curious what sort of civic partnerships, like on the level of the city planning, mm-hmm. And then also on the district level, in terms of the school board, if you have relationships there.
So on the volunteer side, we have people come into the classes and not a lot of heavy lifting, being in there answering questions. The kids can see that somebody is there to help them, to talk to them. So we just try to get people in the room, and then they may have a company or organization. We try to bring kids to there, like the playhouse there. So the volunteerism is opening up resources, being in the classrooms, giving us advice on how we can get more volunteers. So we're kind of a lot of different hats on that. So you don't have to be a programmer, you don't have to be a coder, you don't have to be a technician at any level. Most of these kids just need a little TLC, some encouragement, some support, and then the knowledge piece we bring together later on somewhere. We always have an expert, but they just need to see people helping them. You know, we like to have them, in our classrooms, we like the kids to have fun. Okay, so during the day, they're in a straitjacket, right? They can't move, they can't talk, they gotta raise their hand to go to the bathroom. In our classroom, we just let them have at it, right? So, but we wanna make sure we can track them online to see if they're doing what they're doing. But if they're social and they wanna talk, you know, in that 90 minutes, as long as they get their work done, that's okay. If they wanna look at each other's projects, share ideas, laugh and giggle, because if you've done 6 days or 5 days of school, a 6 day of school is not on your schedule. Okay, so it better be fun, all right? And then if you've been in class all day after school, it has to be fun, all right? So, and those are the kind of things that we want to make sure happen. When it comes to the public-private, most of the time, the civic leaders open up doors for us. They put us in touch with people. They put us in touch with PCC to say, okay, can we use these facilities? They're empty on Saturday mornings. Same with the city. They say, okay, have you thought about this? Did you go to this organization? Go find this person, talk to them, they'll see what you have, what you can do. What we try to do is go where there are no obstacles. We don't have the resources and the time to try to beat down a door. I just need to find the janitor who can unlock the door and let us in, and then we clean it up, and then we leave, and nobody knew we were there, right? And all around town, all around Southern California, Saturday mornings, I'm telling you, a computer lab is empty. Most kids have laptops. There's nobody around. Colleges, I have a 20-year-old college student. I can tell you from experience, they don't get up at 9 o'clock and run to the computer lab. That just doesn't happen. So it's empty, right? So we get them in and get them out. And that's the goal. And that's what we love. And when people can tell us, you should try this place or go here, do that, that's what we like. So it's a win-win for everybody. One last question, this gentleman right here.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I have a question. No. Thank you very much, everybody. Have a nice time. I'm sorry. Great, man.
That was hilarious.
Actually, I have a question about the category of art in STEAM.
Yes.
And you mentioned earlier that oftentimes when schools defer to a minimum amount of programs that are offered, and oftentimes art can be a casualty of that decision making. How does STEAM coders create options for their students to find places where they can incorporate art? So for instance, are you guys also finding ways to partner with Armory for the Arts, for instance, or maybe like Asia Pacific Museum or the PMCA here?
That's our goal. So the art component is the newest piece that we're trying to put together. So we're going to reach out to a lot of the art-related organizations to be able to fill that void. As far as the school goes, we try to work outside of the school system because of the issues, the challenges, the bureaucracy. So to try to get into helping them manage their business is probably not a good use of our time. So we try to work, we kind of run a shadow parallel program. So working through the parents and nonprofit organizations to make sure that the kids have opportunities that may not be available in the school. Schools are probably gonna have to work out their own situation. And if they ask us, we'll offer some advice, but more of it that would be partnering with the other organizations that do have programming and getting the kids to come there.
Excellent, thank you guys.
Thank you guys so much for your questions and your amazing response.